Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for coming. Welcome to Fair Park Baptist Church. And the other half of the church in the lobby will hear us eventually and come on in, I'm sure. But it's great to have each of you here. Great to have guests in our service, as always. Let's stand for a word of prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you and praise you so much for this day. Thank you for your goodness to us. You're an amazing Father. You give good gifts to your children. Would you please bless each and every one here in this service? Thank you for our guests being with us. Thank you for our church family, their love for you, their love for one another. Lord, thank you that you care for each and every one of us. Would you please bless each of us as we seek to honor you, seek to serve you, seek to follow you? I pray that you would just go before us, oh God. Help us to tune our hearts to sing your praise today. Help us to be able to listen and sit at your feet and hear from you. Lord, I thank you for the challenges, trials, tribulation that you allow us to go through in love. And I thank you that you are faithful, who will bring us through those tribulations and those trials and conform us to the image of your Son. We thank you and praise you for your goodness to us. And we just rejoice in you today. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thanks for being here. Let's remain standing. And Brother Chris, would you come and lead us?
Thank you, Pastor. Again, good morning. Jesus saves. How many of you are thankful for that simple truth in those two words? You can raise your hand. You can say amen. I am so thankful, so grateful that we serve a gracious and loving Heavenly Father who sent His Son so that I can have a relationship with Him today. So let's begin singing. We have heard the joyful sound, Jesus saves. And let's just lift up our voices in praise as we begin.
We have heard the joyful sound, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Bear the news to every land, climb the steeps and cross the waves. Onward 'tis our Lord's command, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Wafted on the rolling tide, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Tell to sinners far and wide, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Sing ye islands of the sea, echo back ye ocean caves. Earth shall keep her jubilee, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Sing above the battle strife, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. By his death and endless life, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Sing it softly through the gloom, when the heart for mercy craves. Sing in triumph for the tomb, Jesus saves, Jesus saves.
On the last, sing it out.
Give the winds a mighty voice, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Let the nations now rejoice, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Shout salvation full and free, highest hills and deepest caves. This our song of victory, Jesus saves, Jesus saves.
Oh, that was wonderful. Let's continue. I'm so excited to continue singing. Jesus saves, and now we belong to the King. Let's continue.
I belong to the King. I'm a child of His love. I shall dwell in His palace so fair. For He tells of its bliss in yon heaven above, and His children its splendor shall share. I belong to the King, I'm a child of His love, and He never forsaketh His own. He will call me someday to his palace above. I shall dwell by his glorified throne. I belong to the King, and he loves me, I know. For his mercy and kindness so free are unceasingly mine wheresoever I go, and my refuge unfailing is he.
Sing it out.
I belong to the King. I am a child of his love, and he never forsaketh his own. He will call me someday to his palace above. I shall dwell by his glorified throne. I belong to the King, and his promise is sure that we all shall be gathered at last in his kingdom above. By life's water so pure, when this life with its trials is past.
One more time.
I belong to the King. I'm a child of his love, and he never forsaketh his own. He will call me someday to his palace above. I shall dwell by his glorified throne.
Let's pray together. Father, thank you so much that we are, by Jesus Christ, sons and daughters of you. We are a child of the King. Father, my heart's prayer just now is that we would all just be so encouraged by these words, that we have nothing to fear, regardless of what our physical senses, our eyes, our ears, things we can touch and feel. Lord, those things don't determine this truth, that you are always with us. You will never leave us or forsake us. And Father, I just pray that if there's anyone here that just heard these words, that they would be encouraged in their heart to keep on trusting you, to keep on believing you, to not believe any lies that the enemy may bring, that they're alone, they're misunderstood, they're not heard, but that we would all today, Lord, just be so convinced that you are with us forever in spite of the trials here today. Father, thank you so much that you love us and that we're your children. Pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. This time we're going to invite Brother Gabriel Lopez to come and share a word from the Lord that he has been working through, and we're grateful for him. Brother Gabriel, would you come?
Good morning. Today I wanted to talk about suffering. Now we all know that suffering is an inescapable part of being human. We suffer from the small moments to moments that are so big that it feels like the Lord has turned his face from us. Yet in the midst of our suffering, we must remember that the Lord is always present and will never forsake us. In Psalm 6:1, it says, O Lord, rebuke me not in thine anger, neither chastain me in thy hot displeasure. Have mercy upon me, Lord, for I am weak. Psalm 27:9, hide not thy face far from me. Put not thy servant away in anger. Thou hast been my help. Leave me not, neither forsake me, O God of my salvation. Psalms 13:1. How long wilt thou forget me, O Lord? Forever, how long wilt thou hide thy face from me? How long shall I take counsel in my soul, having sorrow in my heart daily? How long shall mine enemy be exalted over me? Psalm 102:2. Hide not thy face from me. In the day when I am in trouble, incline thine ear unto me. In the day when I call, answer me speedily. and everyone here could probably all put ourselves in the shoes of the psalmist. But however, we must acknowledge that suffering and sorrow is necessary for spiritual growth. In Romans 5, verses 3 and 4, it says, "And not also so, but we glory in tribulations also, knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience hope." In Romans 8, 28, it says, "And we know that all things work together for good, to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose." I think a few weeks ago, I was actually speaking with Mrs. Spivey, and she told me a quote that really resonated with me. She said something along the lines of, "I wouldn't take $1 million for the experience, but I wouldn't go through it again for $1 million. Basically saying, I'm grateful for what I learned, but I wouldn't want to go through it again. And despite that these experiences, you know, we're able to learn a lot, these troubling experiences and tribulations still lead to burden that we must lay at the foot of the cross. And laying it at the foot of the cross ultimately leads to peace. In Philippians 4:7, "And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus." John 14:27, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid." Let us remember that in our suffering, God is not distant, but draws us closer to himself, refining our faith and giving us strength. Let us lay our burdens at the foot of the cross, trusting his promise to carry it. May we embrace the peace that Christ offers, that he is with us in every trial, guiding us with his unfailing love. Thank you.
Thank you, Gabriel, for being willing to come up here and share. You did a great job with that. I'm encouraged, just as I always am, to hear people share, because I love to just know what other people are going through. Helps me just kind of know that I'm not alone. Other people are like me. Do y'all ever feel like you're different? Anybody here ever feel like nobody gets me? Anybody? You know what? That's really just not true. We are very much alike in so many areas, and Satan works so hard to keep us from the truth of there's no temptation taking you, but such as is common to man. And the struggles we go through are just, you know, they're just that. And, you know, it really is just, it's neat. Thank you, Gabriel. I don't want to expound on that because you did a great job with that. But just be encouraged. The Lord is with you. Let's all stand. We're going to continue lifting up our voices in praise. Come, Christians, join to sing. And you can just sing as loud as you can. That's okay with me. But let's just keep our focus on our Savior and worship him. Let's continue.
Come, Christians, join to sing. Alleluia, amen. Loud praise to Christ our King. Alleluia, amen. Let all with heart and voice before his throne rejoice. Praise is his gracious choice. Alleluia, amen. Come, lift your hearts on high. Alleluia, amen. Let praises fill the sky. Alleluia, amen. He is our guide and friend. To us he'll condescend. His love shall never end. Alleluia, amen. Praise yet our Christ again. Alleluia, amen. Life shall not end the strain. Alleluia, amen. On heaven's blissful shore, his goodness we'll adore, singing forevermore. Alleluia, amen.
And let's finish our time with "Be Exalted, O God."
I will give thanks to thee, O Lord, among the people. I will sing praises to thee among the nations. For thy steadfast love is great, is great to the heavens, and thy faithfulness, thy faithfulness to the clouds. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let thy glory be over all the earth. Exalted, O God, above the heavens, let thy glory be over all the earth.
Let's sing that again from the beginning.
I will give thanks to thee, O Lord, among the people. I will sing praises to thee among the nations. For thy steadfast love is great, is great to the heavens, and thy faithfulness to the clouds.
Sing it out.
Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let thy glory let thy glory be over all the earth.
Amen. Wonderful singing. You may be seated.
you. Like a shepherd, lead us. Beautiful, beautiful. How many of you were thinking about some of the words to that song as you were listening? It's maybe not one that we sing every day, but many of us know the words there of just a shepherd leading us step by step. We have a good shepherd. We're grateful for that. Turn in your Bibles, if you would, to 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1. I may be a little bit ambitious here, but I'd like to begin reading the entirety of chapter 1 together as a congregation. And as you're turning there, I just want to say it's so good to see so many friends. Lord Amazing, good to have you in our service. Great to have Evan here back again. And then Kevin in the back. Wave your hand, Kevin. Good to see you too. Thank you for joining us. I'm sure there's others that I overlook, but good to have guests and friends here. Thank you, Robbie. I see your hand too. Good to see you. Yes, glad to have you here. 1 Peter chapter 1. Let's stand for the reading of God's word and let's read responsively. I'll read the odd verses. You read the even verses with me. And that way, when you hear all the names of the towns, you'll know how to pronounce them or how not to pronounce them if you listen close to me. But let's begin reading in 1 Peter chapter 1. We'll read responsibly every other verse you read, and we'll read all the way through verse 25. 1 Peter 1, verse 1. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the strangers scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through sanctification of the Spirit, unto obedience and the sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ. Grace unto you and peace be multiplied. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope, by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time, wherein ye greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, ye are in heaviness through manifold temptations, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto the praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen, ye love, in whom, though now ye see him not, yet believing, ye rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls, of which salvation the prophets have inquired and searched diligently, who prophesied of the grace that should come unto you, searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ which was in them did signify, when it testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow, unto whom it was revealed that not unto themselves, but unto us they did minister the things which are now reported unto you by them that have preached the gospel unto you with the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven, which things the angels desire to look into. Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to the former lusts in your ignorance, but as he which hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation, because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. And if ye call on the Father, who without respect of persons judgeth according to every man's work, pass the time of your sojourning here in fear. For as much as ye know that ye were not redeemed with corruptible things, as silver and gold, from your vain conversation, received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you, who by him do believe in God, that raised him up from the dead and gave him glory, that your faith and hope might be in God, seeing ye have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit, unto unfeigned love of the brethren, see that ye love one another with a pure heart fervently, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. For all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man as the flower of grass. The grass withereth, and the flower thereof falleth away, but the word of the Lord endureth forever. And this is the word which by the gospel is preached unto you. This morning's message is taken primarily from verse 7, but the entirety of the chapter and book is the context. Verse 7 says that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto the praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. The message has been titled, The Crucible. The Crucible. None of us like jumping in the fire, but we do like the result of purified gold. Today, I'd like to share three crucibles that we all will go through at some point or another. The crucible of character, the crucible of conduct, and if we pass those tests, the crucible with Christ. We're in the crucible with Christ. Let's thank the Lord. Father, thank you for your word. If nothing else is said or done from this point forward, we have spent our time in a worthwhile manner, listening, reading the holy, matchless, infallible word that you've given to us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for each one being here. Thank you for the crucibles you allow in our life. I pray that you would help each one of us to be able to walk worthy of the calling wherewith you have called us. And that in the trial of our faith, we'd find that gold more precious, tried with fire, might be found to the praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. We love you. Thank you for your word. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Whenever I mention certain guests, I overlook others. I failed to mention the Covey family. So good to have the Coveys all the way up from Vider, Texas, or Orange, or wherever you call it. But down there in South Texas, we're grateful for them being here in our service. Whenever you're in a trial, few people realize the heat that you're facing. And oftentimes when we're in the midst of a fire, we may not have as much compassion for someone else who's in their trial of affliction. Unfortunately, sometimes we focus exclusively on the trial that we're going through, and we fail to reach out and see the compassion that God would have for others who are in their trial of affliction. Now, I praise the Lord that His grace is sufficient for us. His grace is sufficient for us. And sometimes we begin to compare our trials with others. I want to challenge all of us really quickly just to thank God for the trial that you're going through. How many of you love trials? Can I see your hand? We have a counseling office that we're going to start in the back. If you really like trials, but yet they're more precious than gold. How many want a gold ring this morning? Anybody want a gold ring? Free? A few kids raise a hand. Yeah, you can't have it. I'm sorry. But if you were to look at it as that good, we would all thank God for it. Brother Gabriel, God has used your words. In fact, you might have gotten my outline, but somehow we hadn't even talked about exactly what he was going to share about. God used Miss Hillary Spivey's words in Brother Gabriel's life. And few of us know what trials we may be going through. Many times, though, if we're willing to keep our eyes up on the Savior, we can then have compassion towards others. So number one, thank God for it. Number two, embrace the heat. It will not exceed His grace. By the way, this is not the outline. This is just the outline I got right this morning, so I didn't put it in the PowerPoint. Thank God for it. Embrace the heat. It will not exceed the grace. Now, it would be wonderful if we only purified pure gold, but none of us are pure gold. There will always be dross that will be purified from our lives if we embrace the heat. The worst thing you can do, though, is to break the crucible, because then not only will the gold not be purified, but it'll be contaminated with the elements of the crucible, and all of it will then have to go back into the fire. You know, when we were blessed to be able to get our house in the hills of Bear Creek, we got it from a man that liked things, and he had a lot of things that were left over, and some might call it a hoarder. I think he was just planning for the future. I don't know exactly how you'd look at it, but there was a lot of little things that we found that didn't make sense. Some of them, in fact, 98% probably ended up in the trash, but there was a few little items that we kept that were helpful. some building material. There was even a few little pieces of silver that we found. In finding these pieces of silver, they didn't particularly match with anything. I look them up on eBay. They weren't really part of a set or anything super valuable. In fact, many of them were bent or broken or scarred or, you know, scratched or whatnot. But somebody that I met with who does a whole bunch with antiques and with collectibles and things like that, he said, you know, don't throw any of that away because I can always melt it down and turn it in for silver. So I got to know this guy, and he began to help me to understand the process of smelting. Smelting is where the precious metal is heated to great extent. There's often a type of resin or some sort of thing that the impurities are bonded to, and then the impurities are taken away with that thing that you put in there. I don't remember if it's resin. I think it is resin. You put some resin in there. You heat it up incredibly hot. The resin bonds with the impurities. The impurities are then taken away, and there that has remained is nothing but pure silver. I know of a man who came 2,000 years ago, took upon himself the sins of the whole world. He went through suffering as a man. In fact, he was acquainted with grief. He was a man of sorrows. He was crucified for you and for me. He took upon himself the sins of all the world, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. He gave us the power to live the Christian life. He gave us the ability to walk through the trials. Not only just the ability, he said, I'll be with you in the trials. He is the good shepherd. He walks through the valley of the shadow of death. We don't have to fear because he is with us. All of us have different trials. Just about every week, as I'm driving home from work, I try and call some of my family. Dad, mom, I got several brothers and sisters to choose from. Usually pick up a phone, give it a try. There's some I almost always have success with and some that I never can get a hold of. This week as I was driving home, picked up the phone and called my dad. Those phone calls may not have been. As many of you know, the same day that former President Trump was shot, my dad had a little accident, fell, brain bleed, ICU, hospital, now just made it home. He's been through a trial. It takes incredible effort for him to get any words out. Now, my dad is a fairly quiet guy. It took a tremendous amount to get words out when he could speak perfectly. But with a quivering voice and with great effort, he said, there's a verse that's become very special to me. Over about 3 minutes' time, he shared this verse. I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. He said, Dad, I learned that when I was 3 or 4 or 5. Dad's 78 and learning that in a special way. I'll never leave thee nor forsake thee. I highlight my dad's trials in some respects, but all of you are going through trials. Some of you have already passed through a trial. You're gaining a little bit of a sigh of relief, recharging, energizing in the scripture. You've got the green pastures that you're walking through. You're getting sustenance because if you're still in this life, there will be another trial. Be encouraged. There's another one to go through. And 1 Peter was writing to a scattered church, scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. This is the church that was purchased by Christ's precious blood and now is scattered abroad through persecution, through trials, through being disowned by family, by being shunned by the religious elite, by being persecuted by the Roman government. This is a church that is barely alive and yet scattered. And now Peter is writing to them saying, be encouraged. Your trials are more precious than gold. Wouldn't trade them for $1 million. Wouldn't be willing to go through them again for $1 million. And yet those trials are there to refine us. Thank God for it. Embrace the heat. It will not exceed the grace. Allow the dross to be revealed and skimmed off the top. Another point, the Lord just stay useful and usable. Stay useful and usable. As obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to the former lust in your ignorance, verse 14 says, but as he which hath called you is holy, so be holy in all manner of conversation. Yeah, that means talk, but it means far more than talk. It means action. It means your conduct. It means every aspect of who you are. Stay useful. Stay usable. Number five, and this is not in the outline, but stay in the crucible until it's finished. I was doing some welding yesterday. I enjoy doing things with my hands once in a while, and sometimes there's little projects that are broken, and I get excited because I like fixing things. Not very good at it. Just get me a bigger hammer. I'll fix it somehow. But I was welding, and I was enjoying this little process there, and I was trying different rods, and stick welding is not something I ever was trained in. I just learned it out of necessity on the farm. You know, when an implement is broken, you just put as much metal on that thing as you can and beef it up, okay? So none of my welding is pretty. All of it is utilitarian. It gets the job done, maybe. If it doesn't get the job done, we'll try it next time. So I'm there welding, and I'm realizing, deep in thought, as the sparks are flying, I'm realizing that we're taking two metals that are closely aligned, and we're adding a third metal that is hot to be able to bring the two metals to union. The crucible. The more heat you apply, the more heat melds those metals together, unless you overdo it and it blows a hole in the metal. I'm grateful that His grace is sufficient for me. Just as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were in the fiery furnace, Christ appeared. The trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found to the praise and honor and glory. What? At the appearing of Jesus Christ. You haven't stayed in the trial long enough till Jesus is appearing and precious. You haven't stayed in the trial long enough until Christ is formed in you. Now for the message. Number one. Before we even get to the message here, what is a crucible? Really quickly here, what is a crucible? A crucible, I looked it up in the dictionary, a chemical vessel or melting pot made of earth and so tempered and baked as to endure extreme heat without melting. It is used for melting ores and metals, etc. You saw the picture of the crucible, but that's the dictionary definition of crucible. The crucible might be very different for you. It might be the crucible of cancer. Might be the crucible of limes. It might be the crucible of a health malady. It might be the crucible of a trial, of losing a job. It might be the crucible of family that is walking away from the Lord. It might be we don't know what the crucible is, but don't break the crucible. It is made to refine you. It is made to apply the heat, to withstand the heat so the precious metal can be refined. 1 Peter 1:7 reveals, number one, the crucible of character. Character is who you are when you think no one else is watching. Character could be described as the essence of who you are. Trials will test our character. Trials will not only test our character, but they reveal our character. And thirdly, trials will showcase your character. Look at the character qualities just mentioned in the beginning of this passage. If you were to read through this passage, just looking for a few of the highlights of the character qualities, it is really the process by which the big theological word sanctification is used in the Scriptures. Sanctification is you growing to a deeper relationship with Christ till Christ be formed in you. Sanctification of spirit unto obedience. Obedience is one of the most rudimentary, fundamental principles, character qualities every believer needs to have. Doesn't matter how much you know about the Bible if you're not doing the Bible. That's why obedience is the foundation we teach our children. Because until we learn to obey, we're not ready to learn more. Sanctification. Look at the next one. Obedience and the sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ. Verse 2, grace. You might say, well, that's not really a character quality I've learned of. Well, we need grace, and grace is an attribute of who God is. The law came by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. When we have grace, we have power to face the challenges of today. His grace is sufficient for me. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my crucible, my infirmity, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. And then comes along this beautiful word, peace. Peace be multiplied unto you. Peace is not the absence of conflict, but the calm in the midst of the storm. The peace that is in a world full of tribulation, be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. It is the confidence that He is with you, not giving you a bypass or a detour or a special alternate route around trouble, but being with you in trouble. And then it continues on in verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to His abundant mercy, mercy would be another quality, hath begotten us again into a lively hope. I might have preached a message or two on that one. Hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Hey, if this life is all it's about, we are of all men most miserable, but there is a resurrection. These present trials we're in are but for a moment, and they work for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. Praise the Lord, this life is not what it's all about. There's a life that we're living for. It's a life eternal. It's incredible. It's exceeding weight of glory. And then we see the word faith coming in verse 5. Who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation. By the way, it's not fake it till you make it. It's not grin and bear it. It's not white knuckle Christianity, just barely making by. No. Who are kept by the power of God through faith. Through faith. Unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time, wherein ye greatly rejoice. Rejoicing in suffering is one of the vital qualities of every believer. Rejoicing in difficult times. Paul and Silas in the Philippian jail, singing their hearts content, belting it out like some of us might do in the shower, except they were in the midst of suffering. The blood oozing from their backs as they lay on the infectious floor, rats scurrying about their feet, groans and mockings and scorning of other prisoners, family missing them, loneliness echoing through the dark, dank chambers of a dark prison cell. Incarcerated for what? Maybe they did something terrible. Maybe there's something we don't know about. But what did they do? They rejoiced in the midst of trials and tribulation. Singing to their heart's content. You know, when you're in the midst of a trial and you sing, you are all of a sudden in the presence of God, because in His presence is fullness of joy. We are to enter into His gates with thanksgiving and into His courts with praise. We are to be thankful unto Him and to bless His name. We can have the best worship services in all the world when I sing, when we lift our voices in praise to God in the midst of our trials. Oh, Pastor David, when I'm on a vacation, then I'll lift my voice in praise to God. When I'm in the wonderful time where all my family's getting along perfectly, then I'll sing praise to God. When I've got ample money in the bank account and the gas price is $2 a gallon and we have Trump back in office, well, then I'll praise God. No, you won't. If you won't do it today, you won't do it ever. Because thankfulness is not a condition of our happenings. Thankfulness and thanksgiving is a condition of our spirit rejoicing that Christ is King. That is not determined by a political stance. That is not determined by our external circumstances. That is determined by one thing and one thing alone. Christ is Lord of all. And if He's Lord of all in your life, He has allowed these circumstances for His glory and for Him to shine through our circumstances. Some of us, some of you, will go through trials and you'll ask God why. One of the hardest questions that I hear as a pastor. But God, why? Pastor, why would God allow this? Why am I going through this? It's okay to ask the question why. Jesus did it on the cross. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? And that question is important. But the more important thing is not whether you've asked the question, but who you're asking it to. Because whoever you ask the question of is likely who will give you the answer. If you're asking friends, if you're asking Facebook, if you're asking all sorts of places, but you failed to ask Christ alone, you will get some distorted answers. But if you ask the person of Jesus Christ, He longs to give you the answer. Will you lean close? Will you listen to His whisper? I'm with you. I will work all things together for good. This is not in vain. This too will pass. This is working for you a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. You see, earthly trials bring heavenly treasures. Did you get that? The more trials, the more treasures. Oh God, dish me out some trials then. No, sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. His grace is sufficient for you, but don't take on tomorrow's cares with the grace of today. Today is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. God has sovereignly allowed what we can handle, and He will not give you more than you can handle. Trials showcase that character. These trials help you to endure patiently and produce treasure in heaven. Somebody once said, sow a thought, reap an action. Sow an action, reap a habit. Sow a habit, reap a character. Sow a character, reap a destiny. Be careful with your thought life. Your thoughts are incredibly important as you're walking through the crucible of character. The deeper the trials, the more you long for heaven, the more you store up riches in heaven, the more you live for eternity. This life is not what it's here and about. Listen to Hebrews chapter 1, verses 2 and 3. This is, to my knowledge, the only time the word character is mentioned. You say, Brother David, in the King James, it doesn't say the word character. No, but the Greek is literally the transliteration of the word character. If you know the word character, you know Greek. It is a Greek word translated here, I think, very beautifully, the express image of His person. Hebrews 1, verses 2 and 3 says, who being in the brightness of His glory and the express image of His person and upholding all things by the word of His power, when He had by Himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the Majesty on high. The more of the character of Christ is formed in us, the more sanctification has taken place. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. What is the first part? I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. The life that I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God who gave Himself for us. As Johnny Pope, preacher down in Houston area, has said, new levels, new devils. The deeper you go with Christ, the more you realize Satan hates you. Satan hates you because you were made to reflect the very image of Christ, the very character of Christ, the essence of who He is. We're not out for a walk in the park. We're not here to play in the playground. We're on a battleground. Whenever God takes you to, whenever God wants to take you further, He will often take you deeper. And the deeper is not always fun. It's usually dark. It's usually lonely. It's usually pressure-filled, but yet that deeper is deeper with Christ. God is more interested in conforming us to the image of His Son than us portraying our desired image to the world. Somebody once said, surmounting difficulty is the crucible that forms character. I've heard it said that we all want to see a miracle. Very few of us want to be in the place where we need one. In the crucible with Christ forms the character of Christ. Who you are is not defined by what you do, but what you do reveals who you are. James 1, 2 through 4 puts it this way, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations, trials, hardships, pain, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience, character, but the patience have her perfect work, that you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. When hard times come, rejoice. Sometimes hard is good. Not everybody wants to sign up for basic training in the Army, Marines, Navy, Air Force. But the hardship that they endure, 9, 12 weeks, I don't know what the basic trainings are, is to form or reveal or test or try the character to see what it is. How many of you are in basic training with Jesus? But my drill instructor doesn't look like Jesus. Yeah, that's the point. The point is not to show how good your drill instructor is. The point is to make you more like Christ. Your drill instructor may take many different forms and fashions. Maybe a boss at work, maybe a trial at home, maybe a challenge with health. They all take different forms. As long as they're forming you to the person of Jesus Christ, bring it on. Because it makes us who God has called us to be. The 1 Peter chapter 2 says, "For what glory is it if when ye be buffeted for your faults, ye shall take it patiently? But if when ye do well and suffer for it, ye take it patiently, this is acceptable with God. For even hereunto are ye called, because Christ also has suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps. Who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. Who when he was reviled, reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judgeth righteously." Pastor David, I thought if I followed Jesus, the suffering would be gone. I thought if I became a Christian, my life would be so much better. It'd be heaven on earth. No, heaven isn't heaven. This earth is not my home. I'm just a passing through. May we, as pilgrims and strangers in this life, long for that city, but embrace the hardships, the trials, the challenges, as tools in the Master's hand, as heat in the crucible, till Christ be formed in us. You know, if we were all perfect Christians, trials would showcase Christ. But none of us are perfect Christians, and the trials are to purify us, a peculiar people, a unique, special people, zealous of good works, which God has foreordained that we should walk in them. And so these trials are to allow the character of Christ to be reflected in us. I've mentioned it before, I'll mention it today. Whenever a refiner, a smelter, is looking to bring pure gold, pure silver, pure metal to its full potential, its full purity, he will heat it and heat it and heat it, skim the dross, until finally he peers into it and sees his own reflection. These trials and temptations are to purify. They're not as punishment, but for purification. And it reveals the dross. But how many of you know that sometimes when we're going through a trial and God is purifying us, we can have Job's three friends show up. And they know the Bible. They know what's wrong with you and they're there to fix it. They're God's messengers to help you. Remember, this world's not my home. Sometimes even family. Curse God and die. What lovely advice from a wise spouse. I'm being facetious there. Yet, though he slay me, yet will I trust in him. Though he slay me, yet will I trust in him. None of us have been killed for the gospel's sake. But it may come to that. The only way we'll be ready to die for Jesus is if we're willing to live with Jesus in the suffering, in the trials, in the tribulation. Because tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience hope, and hope make not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts. Jesus loves you. That's why he's allowing suffering and trial and tribulation in your life. And sure, if we're buffeted for our faults, we take it patiently. What glory is that? If we're just going to endure having the same rotten attitude we've always had without letting Christ cleanse and purify us, there's no glory in that. But when the trials reveal the dross is skimmed, we become vessels unto honor. Comes to number two, the crucible of character. By the way, Jesus went through crucibles as well. The crucible of the cross, the crucible of the garden, the crucible of temptations in the wilderness, being deserted by his disciples. He had the most unsuccessful ministry ever known to man. His closest associates forsook him and fled. He only had a 3.5-year ministry. No, he's had a ministry for all of eternity. He ever lives to make intercession for us. He's in full-time prayer ministry. He says, if they hated me, they will also hate you. If they were persecuted me, they will also persecute you. The crucible of conduct. 1 Peter 1:15-16 says, but as he which hath called you is holy, so be ye holy. How many of you are as holy as Christ is holy? Raise your hand. every hand should go up because Christ died for you. And when God sees you, he doesn't see the sin that we have once held. He sees the Son who paid for your sin, and he loves you as much as he loves his Son, Jesus. I am crucified with Christ. I am in Christ. Christ in me, the hope of glory. Your good conduct will certainly not get you to heaven, but poor conduct might keep others from going there. That is why we are commanded by God to be ye holy. We are called by a heavenly calling, a much higher calling. We're not redeemed with corruptible things, verse 18 says, as silver and gold from your vain conversation, received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. He's the only one that's ever been on the earth without blemish and without spot. As God brings you to reflect his character, he also desires to see it produce his conduct through us. Notice again verse 7, the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto the what? Praise. That's conduct, how we live our lives. And honor. That's how we demonstrate him first in our life. And glory. Herein is my Father glorified that ye bear much fruit. If we are not bearing fruit, we may not be bringing God glory. The fruit that God is looking from our lives needs to be good fruit, lest he cut it down and hew it and throw it into the fire and it is burned. May God produce good fruit through us, not as something to earn salvation, but as evidence that there is salvation. Because if there is a root, there will be fruit that is to the honor and glory and praise of Jesus Christ. Our talk is so cheap, but actions speak louder than words. As James puts it, faith without works is dead. Somebody once said, your talk talks and your walk talks, but your walk talks louder than your talk talks. Even my tongue got tangled up on that one. Your talk talks and your walk talks, but your walk talks louder than your talk talks. In jail, Tuesday nights, we do prison ministry, and so often many of the men have confused actions as being what validates salvation. Actions as being a part of salvation. Well, I'm a good person, therefore I should be saved. I will be saved. And their faith is so often in themselves instead of in the person of Jesus Christ. Because in reality, their spirit was saved many years ago, some of them. They were born again by the Spirit of God, but their soul was never transformed by the Word of God. Received with meekness the engrafted Word, which is able to save your souls. And so often they're walking in a soulish carnality that has led to bondage in their flesh, addictions to drug, alcohol, gangs, you name it. And because of the hardness of their hearts, though they may be saved in their spirit, there's very little fruit in their flesh. So they doubt the spiritual transaction that took place at Calvary. And that is why it's so important that they come to that where they walk in the Spirit. So their soul is under the submission of the Spirit. And they begin to be all that God has called them to do. And their conduct becomes that which becometh a Christian, that which shows forth the character of Christ through conduct that honors the Lord. We know that crowns, awards, certificates, accolades, and praise all fades. But the enduring reward for all of eternity that never dims or grows old is the fullness of joy at the presence of Jesus. Because we know how fickle and futile the human crowns and accolades and awards are, we so often fail to do the works God has called us to do. Well, I don't want to be in vain glory handing out a gospel tract or pat myself on the back because two souls were saved at jail ministry last week. I just want to, well, hold on. Maybe God does want to be glorified because it wasn't him that saved him. It wasn't me that did these things. It was Christ who did these things through a weak, broken vessel. If we really believed in eternal reward for faith and suffering, we would embrace the suffering. If we had the stack, briefcase full of money, or trials of afflictions, from the eyes of eternity, we would go to the trials of afflictions every time. so important that we live for that which matters most in eternity. Trials in this life are but for a moment. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. You see, the trials we go through can either turn us inward or upward. We can either have a pity party or a praise party. We can either choose to honor God who allowed the suffering or get bitter at the circumstances which seem to inflict the pain. Trials can be used to chasten or purify, but either way, they're a beautiful thing when our eyes are on Christ. Somebody texted me kind of randomly the other day. They live up in Michigan. They just texted me, "You know you're over the target when you start catching heavy flack." Trials may be sickness or health crisis. And yet, one of the most beautiful, radiant, loving people, Brother Mike, I think of your precious Kathy, who's now with the Lord, in the midst of her suffering, shown the love of Jesus. Yesterday, but a week ago, we had the precious privilege of exalting the name of Christ by praising the work that God had done through Miss Kathy in the hearts and lives of so many, specifically her children. What a beautiful thing. I think of that precious hymn, "Day by Day, and with each passing moment, strength I find to meet my trials here, trusting in my Father's wise bestowment. I've no cause for worry or for fear. Passing of a loved one can be a great trial of affliction. Loss of material goods or property, financial struggles, friendships that are lost or broken, legal battles, character maligned, persecution for standing for right. You say, but what if some of these things were caused because they did something wrong? God's in charge of that. He's going to purify. He's going to take care of the wrong motives. He's going to cleanse the sin. That's not our job. Oh, we're eager to be Job's three friends, but will we trust him in the midst of the storm? Think of a few of the heroes of faith. I think of Charles Wesley, who authored scores of hymns. His house was burned down by arson. I believe he was the one that was the brand plucked from the fire, either him or John Wesley. His father was in and out of jail for nearly his entire growing up years because he wasn't paying his debts. He was a preacher. He was one of 18 siblings, and out of those 18 siblings, 10 of them died, either very soon after being born or a little bit later in life. Yet God used him to found the Methodist movement, which back in its day was following God passionately, purely, started the Holiness Club. He was one of the great revivalists of the 1700s, and yet, if you look at his biography, he was one that was separated from his wife. Please don't rip out his hymns out of the hymnal, having heard that, because the Word of God is powerful, and God used him to preach forth that Word. In fact, many heroes of the faith have gone through trials and heartache that we will never know. Many of them were accused by fellow Christians of heresy, misconduct. Does that mean we look the other way? No, it means we pray all that much more. Corrie Ten Boom hid the Jews. She lost her entire family to the Nazis. She spoke against the political regimen of the day, the political force that was coming through, but yet God used her in a mighty way in the concentration camps, after the concentration camps, before the concentration camps. She survived it. She's known to have said, "There is no pit so deep that God is not deeper still." Does danger hinder our conduct? Do we fear or shrink back because of fear of personal torture, personal harm? Does fear of pain keep you from doing right? She used the illustration of one day when she asked her dad a question that she was not ready to receive the answer for regarding moral purity. He says, "Corrie, pick up my suitcase." She struggled and strained. She said, Casper Ten Boom looked down at Corey and says, "You're not ready to pick up that suitcase yet." Similarly, as they were traveling to set their pocket watch according to the Amsterdam clock, she says, "Daddy, what about what's all going on around here? What if we get taken to a concentration camp? What if we are tortured? What if we are killed?" Casper Ten Boom looks down at Corey and says, "Corey, when do I give you your ticket for the travel on the train? Is it years ahead of time? Weeks? Months? Or just before you need it?" God doesn't often give us the ticket ahead of time, but He will give us the ticket when we need it. Trials in Heroes of the Faith. Corey Ten Boom, Charles Wesley, Fanny Crosby. A fake doctor, much of which we may have today, burned her eyes with putting mustard poultices on her eyes, parading around as this physician and yet had no credentials. She had no particular pity party that I'm aware of, no real complaining, no real bickering or murmuring, but a hymn of praise, yea, even 8,000 hymns of praise, and many more that we don't ever know about because of all the pseudonyms she wrote under. Physically blind, she gave spiritual sight to millions. She wrote over 9,000 hymns, songs, spiritual songs. I was listening to a little clip from Adrian Rogers this week, preacher down in Florida. He said that a grumpy husband was always bickering about his breakfast. Finally, one day, his wife said, "Okay, God, give me the grace. I will do what I can to make his breakfast exactly how he wants it." The bickering husband was getting up, and his wife leaned over and says, "Sweetie, can I make you breakfast?" "Yeah, the usual." "Can I just make sure I know what that is?" "Yes, I want one fried egg and one scrambled egg." The wife carefully cooked the meal, brought it to him, and he looked up at her and says, "What'd you do? You scrambled the wrong egg." Some people are just near impossible to please. Some people may even go on to a banquet. They're totally unable to enjoy the banquet because the china was chipped. Do you know the problem in both those circumstances? The people weren't hungry. We live in a church in a day and age where people are not hungry. They're not hungry for the Word of God because the pastor scrambled the wrong egg. The pastor has flawed character, chips in his vessel. The fellow congregants complain, murmur. "There's problems," they say. Let's distance ourselves from the problems. Then our pain will be alleviated. Let's go to the perfect church where there is no chip in the china. Every egg is fried to order. Every challenge is already overcome. We can just bask. The problem is not the church. The problem is the hunger of the people for the Word of God. God can use a donkey to preach a powerful message. Yes, God longs for clean vessels with which He can use, and I want to be every bit the clean vessel that God has called me to be. And I pray that each one of us are purified, that the trial of our faith being much more precious than of gold. Listen to some of the heroes of Scripture. Paul, thorn in the flesh, not trusted by the early church because of his past as Saul, the persecutor. Joseph, sold as a slave, falsely accused, thrown in prison, starts a prison ministry. Esther, parents likely killed by the king that she went to serve, raised by an uncle. Can you imagine an uncle that would put you up for a beauty pageant to be taken by a wicked king? Except God told him. Except God led him. Didn't make sense. Probably wasn't too well received by the rest of the Jewish nation. Yet God used her to serve a king and spared the people of Israel. Daniel, in Babylonian captivity, made a eunuch, suffered in an incredible way. And yet God used him in the lion's den just as much as in the king's palace. His success was not whether he was in the king's palace or in the lion's den, but in his walk with God, of which they could find no fault except that he had that walk with God. None of us are Daniels. None of us are Josephs. There's a few guys, who was I talking to earlier, that said there are a few men in Scripture where there's absolutely nothing said of them negatively in Scripture. Enoch was one. Joseph is one. Daniel is one. Nothing negative that they did. Interesting to see Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace praising God, and the Son of Man appears. Jesus, the pre-incarnate Christ. Jonah, boy, he messed up a fair bit. Murmured that he had to go preach to his former relatives that likely murdered his parents, relatives. God used him. In fact, to illustrate the resurrection of Christ, the most pivotal event of all of history. Abraham, boy, he had some trouble. His wife was barren, so he went and had a kid with another woman. What kind of a man of God is that? Yet he trusted God. God used him to be the father of our faith, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Job. Number three is the crucible with Christ. The crucible with Christ. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. I've already touched on this throughout the entirety of the sermon. But I just want to challenge you, in the midst of your crucible, turn to Christ. In the midst of crisis, turn to Christ. Do we really believe Romans 8, 28 through 29? And we know that all things work together to good, for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to His purpose. For whom He did foreknow, He also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of His Son. The crucible is for Christ to be formed in you. What valley are you walking through? What crisis are you managing to navigate? What trials are you walking through? You can get bitter at the crucible and break the crucible, but the only thing that's damaged is the silver. The silver must be heated and the dross removed so that Christ can be reflected by our lives. Crucibles reveal character of Christ. They demonstrate the conduct of Christ until the love of Christ is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given to us. The essence of all that we're going through is in verse 22. Seeing ye have purified your soul and obeying the truth of the Spirit unto unfeigned love, genuine love, unhypocritical love of the brethren. See that ye love one another with a pure heart fervently. Our problem is not so much with one another, but our love for the Lord has grown cold. God allows trials because He cares more about our love toward us. Would we turn to Him in times of crisis? Will trials reveal your trust in Christ? Or will the crucible reveal cracks or chinks in our armor and in the character of Christ? Let me close with this passage in Isaiah 43. 1 through 2. But now thus saith the Lord that created thee, O Jacob, and He that formed thee, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed thee. I have called thee by thy name. Thou art mine. When thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee, and through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. Botchery, unless you cling to Christ. Some of you will face your trials without Christ because you've never put your faith and trust in Jesus alone for salvation. There may be one of you here in this room today who is not saved. You can know for sure if you died today, you would go to be with Jesus in heaven. Is there anyone here that say, Pastor, I'm one of those people you're talking about. I don't have Christ in my life. If I died today, I don't know if I would go to heaven. Could you pray for me? I'd love to pray for you. Slip your hand up and then down. Anybody here like that at all? Second of all, I want to challenge you to embrace the crucible. Embrace the fire. It will not overflood you. It will not overtake you. It will not be greater than what you are able to do. His grace is sufficient for you. Embrace the fire. Embrace the crucible. I don't know everyone that is here super well. I don't know, whatever trials or tribulation you may be going through, but how many of you would be willing to say, Pastor, pray for me. God has me in a little bit of a crucible right now, a little bit of a trial. Could you slip your hand up and then down all across this room? Thank you. Thank you. Would you allow that crucible to produce the character of Christ in you, the conduct of Christ in you, by reminding yourself that you are in the crucible with Christ? The pianist is going to play. Would you just talk to God about the trial you've walked through, the trials you are walking through, or the trials you may walk through soon? And would you ask God for the grace to trust Him in the midst of the crucible? I don't know what that trial will be for you. I want to challenge you not to compare your crucible with someone else's. Would you embrace the crucible with Christ? You're welcome to come to the altar. The altar is open. You're also welcome to pray in your seats. But would you embrace the crucible? Thank God for that crucible that you're in right now. Father, thank you for the crucibles you allow in our hearts and in our lives. Thank you for the crucible of character. Thank you for the crucible of conduct. Help us to take every crucible with you, Christ. Till Christ be formed in you. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Lord, thank you for the impurities that are surfaced through trials. Thank you for even revealing challenges in my life this past week, this past month, this past year and a half. Many of them. I want to thank you for that surfacing. We praise you, O God. You are so good to us to give us trials. Trials that we would never go through for $1 million, but trials we would never trade for the lessons we've learned, the things we've experienced. Wouldn't train him for $1 million. Bless this church family. Help us to embrace the crucible, allowing you to skim the dross from our lives. Bring forth a vessel for the refiner. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you for your patience this morning. Just a few quick announcements here before we are dismissed. Once again, thank you so much to our guests for being here today. Honored to have the Coveys here. Brother Evan, great to have you here as well. And I know that Brother Kevin had to slip out for a work appointment at noon, but great to have each one of you here. Brother Gabriel, thank you for sharing that word. Your message was much shorter than mine, but had all the points there. That was good. A couple brief announcements here. We're going to begin our children's choir Wednesday nights, kind of as a part or a tandem to the Wednesday PM services. So we're looking forward to that beginning on September the 4th. We also have evangelist John Van Gelderen coming to preach, coming up there prior to our church family camps. You see those both in the bulletin. Today, I want to highlight to you the Faith Bible Institute. No, it's not an FBI within the government. We're having a semester there. Faith Bible Institute, phenomenal three-year course on the Bible, Old Testament survey, New Testament survey, and theology offered each semester. And so it takes 3 years to get through it, but you can just take one semester. There is an opportunity for you to be able to take a sampling of that course this afternoon at 1:30, and that is the first session for this semester six. Semester six will be going from here till mid-December, and we'll be doing that 1:30 on Sunday afternoons. We're looking forward to that. If you're thinking about it, if you thought about it, and you want to check it out, come to the fellowship hall at 1:30 today, and you, I think it's actually in a different classroom, the Damascus, maybe Damascus, I don't remember which one that is. It is the FBI room. Which one? Thank you. Go to Egypt, my son. Out of Egypt have I called my son. Anyway, go to Egypt, and hopefully you won't remain in Egypt forever, but looking forward to that as well. I know a number of you have expressed interest in that. We're looking forward to a great semester starting off with that. Also, coming up on August 30th is Spencer Bivens' birthday. Now, it's not a national holiday, but I'm grateful for those who have been willing to lay down their priorities, their family, lay down everything to be able to go and serve our country in the military. And Spencer has completed his initial time in Army boot camp, but he is going to be away for a while yet. And this is his first time to be away, certainly this long. Just out those back double doors are a few birthday cards provided by the church, and we're going to assemble a bunch of those birthday cards. Each family or each individual is welcome to put a birthday card, little note, praying for you, thinking of you, hoping you're having a good time, whatever it may be, maybe a verse that you want to give him to encourage him. I want to encourage you to support our troops by supporting one of our own by writing him a quick thank you for serving or a quick birthday greeting. I have already written a note for him, and I hope that you'll be able to put those notes together. You can slip them under my door in my office. We're going to put all of them together, put a little care package together with some little goodies, and we're going to ship it off to him once I know exactly what goodies he's allowed at this point. But anyway, let's do that as a way to be able to honor Spencer and show him love and encouragement as he's away. In fact, he may even be watching live stream. I heard rumor he watches some of our live stream. So, Spencer, sorry. I busted your surprise, but anyway, we'll see what we can do there. Any other announcements we may have? Anything else? All right, honored to have each one of you here. Let's stand and let's be dismissed in prayer. Brother William, can I put you on the spot and ask you to close us in a word of prayer as we go from here, and we'll look forward to seeing you Wednesday night.
Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day you've given us to gather together, to worship you, to praise your name, to hear this message. Lord, pray that you would just continue to bless us and guide us while we are in the crucibles of our life, Lord, that you would use them to change us, use them to challenge us, use them to draw us closer to you and to purify us into your image. Lord, pray that you would take this message and apply it into our hearts and apply it into our lives, and that we would be doers of the word and not hearers only, Lord. We thank you for all the people who are here today. Pray that you'd keep us all safe as we travel home and continue with our days. And pray that you'd bring us all back next week. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.